Roll call, please.
Judge Deskins.
Here.
Magistrate Anderson.
Here.
Magistrate Johnson will be here probably. Magistrate Murphy.
Here.
Magistrate Robinson.
Here.
Magistrate Dotson.
Yes.
Magistrate Varney.
Here.
Leo, would you lead us the pledge of allegiance?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mine is on a six, my boy's on a nine.
All right. Approval of the minutes of October the 4th, 2016. Roll call, please.
Magistrate Anderson. Magistrate Murphy. Magistrate Robinson. Magistrate Dotson.
Yes.
Magistrate Varney.
Yes.
Judge Deskins.
Yes. Let me borrow a pen. Thank you. All right.
Hey, Judge, I would like to add one thing to the agenda that we don't have on there, and that is discussion of the budget. We talked that we were going to do that. We just don't have it on the agenda, so I'd like to add that on there, that we will be discussing the budget.
All right. All right. Okay, for approval and discussion, Brian, would you read this, please?
Yeah, we have several things on the agenda, people. The first four or five things is just space that's county owned that we lease out on a yearly basis. We do this every year. If I can, I think I can cover all three or four of them in one swoop. Can I, Rose, and we can just approve them all instead of doing them individually. The first one is the space located over at the Phillips Courthouse. We rent this out to the Cabinet for Health and Family Services.
Brian, it's not the courthouse, it's the building behind the
building behind the courthouse. Yeah. Thank you, Hillman. We get $450 monthly out of that space. The next one would be the basement here in the courthouse. We rent this to the Department of Corrections for Mental Health. We get $343 monthly for that service. Over to the Belfry Courthouse, Bobby, we got space over there that we give to the Cabinet for Health and Family Services. We have no charge.
No charge, and I think that was set up no charge before because there was some remodeling work that they'd done.
Right.
How has that done passed or something? I mean, if we can get a dollar out of it, I'd like to get a dollar out of it.
We contacted the space up on the fourth floor. We've donated that space too. We reached out to them this year, and this will be the first year that they're going to. I think it's $350 a month, so we can reach out to them to see where the agreement is on that space. But going into this year, as of right now, it's no charge. The third floor of this building, we got a good portion space to the probation and parole office through the corrections that we lease out for $1,319.99 monthly. Some property up on Island Creek that we lease out to the State Police Firing Range. I think the Sheriff's Department also uses it, and it's no charge. So that's the five, okay. One, two, three, the five things that we need to get a motion and approve on.
I need a motion in a second.
Okay, I got you.
Roll call, please.
Magistrate Anderson.
Yes.
Magistrate Murphy.
Yes.
Magistrate Robinson. Magistrate Dotson.
Yes.
Magistrate Varney.
Yes.
Judge Deskins.
Yes. All right. Approval to advertise for RFI request for interest for Pike County Development Area. Brian?
Yeah, this is something that Lisa and I have been working on. Lisa's actually brought this to my attention, and we've talked about it, and I think it's a good thing. We have a lot, like, for instance, downstairs in the basement, we have a real nice space down there, which just consists of a conference room, a office, a reception area with a restroom located inside the facility. that it's been empty since we've been here. You know, what we're asking is to get court approval to do a RFI, which is a request for interest. Just get, you know, get it out there through the media that we have this space available to see if we have anybody interested in renting the facility. And, you know, also we got the third floor of the Hall of Justice that's sitting empty. You know, I mean, if we do an RFI on this, you know, hopefully we'll get some interest in it. Lisa, go ahead.
And you also, we have the Hatfield McCoy cabin that we were adding on that. We also have property that's coming to the county that we want to look at too, and have that ready to be development. And also, this is the first step of the P3 process, which will go to legislation in January as far as the regs on that. But at least we're one step ahead trying to get this out before that.
Yeah, I feel like if we put it out there, I think there will be some interest in several locations we got, and we just need court approval to do an RFI on it to see.
Motion.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Master Anderson.
Yes.
Master Murphy.
Yes.
Master Robinson.
Yes.
Master Dotson.
Yes.
Master Varney.
Yes.
Judge Diskin.
Yes. Awarding of bids. No bids. All right. Magistrate Road Work.
Motion.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Master Anderson.
Yes.
Master Murphy.
Yes.
Master Robinson.
Yes.
Master Dotson.
Yes.
Master Varney.
Yes.
Judge Diskin.
Yes. Magistrate's comments. Anderson?
I have no comments this time, Judge.
Oh, Johnson's not here. All right, Murphy?
Yes. Lisa, did you get to work on that Kenny Branch water project?
I have talked to Congressman Rogers' office, and I just finished a conversation with Big Sandy Ad, and we're going to work with Summit and the Mountain Water District to see if we get it in to get it at actually a number to go ahead and start working on that. Not to say it's going to be funded yet,
but
we're going to take our first steps on trying to get it listed as a project and then trying to move forward and trying to find the money. So, yes, we are working on that.
All right. Appreciate it. And I think there should be a finishing or water project up on the Upper Pompey before too long, shouldn't it?
Kenneth?
Just, they're finishing up on the line. They're still working on the pump station.
All right. Thank you.
Hillman?
Thank you, Judge. I got a few things. I noticed on TV this week that Brian had a talk show on there about our, I guess, Get Pike County Fit. Is that the name of it?
Yeah.
And, you know, I thought it was a good show. And I would like to say that I think it would be a good program for our people if we can get them involved. And I talked to the health department yesterday, and they said they had quite a few people come in and sign up for the exercise program. You want to talk about that, Brian?
Well, yeah, if you don't care, him, I don't mean to interrupt
good.
You. I'm glad you brought that up. This is something the health department's doing, and they are a show on Pike TV right now. You know, they're limited space, and I talked with Miss Bartley the other day, and that they're filling up. So anyone interested in doing this needs to be pretty active on it pretty quick. But it's a great program. The health department put it together. They're going to have a dietitian to go over what they can eat. They're going to do cholesterol checks, diabetes checks, weight checks prior to this program starting, and then through the 12-week period at the end of it, they're going to have a final weighing and really educate Pike County on what exercises to do, good dieting habits. So yeah, Hillman, I'm glad you brought it up, and I know the county's very excited to team up with the health department on putting this on.
Can you tell them, Brian, about when it's going to start?
November 1st.
November
1st.
That's
on, you know, different times, but go to Pike TV and they have it listed, the places and dates and times.
Each area will have a different day, right?
Yes,
2 days a week.
2 days a week, Mondays and Wednesdays and Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Be like a morning and evening.
Yeah, yeah.
And I thought it was real good, and you know, it's another way to utilize our our senior citizen centers, and it might encourage and pick up the numbers that we need out in the county for our seniors if they see the,
yep,
the facility. And I appreciate Diana going along with them and working with them, and hopefully it'll work out for everybody. And
yes, I'm going to get with Paul by the end of this week.
But Bill, that was one of the things I wanted to bring up. And another thing is, you know, we have a lot of health issues out in our county with our employees, like Bobby said there. And I've got three men off right now with sickness in their family, and then one had turned in a resignation. He's going to quit. So, you know, we're kind of scraping down low on our employees, and we've been fortunate to get some replacement workers, but we just hope and pray that they'll recover, and hope the people will understand that we're doing all we can. And I thank our crew that's continued to keep the work up, and we're going to do the best we can with it. And
Hillman, you care if I say something?
Go ahead.
I don't mean to interrupt you.
Go ahead.
I promise I don't. But you do have one resigning over on your lot, and during their layoffs, during their last budget cut, you know, the majority, I think we laid off 19, and I think 10 of them we've got back on in county jobs. But one of the people we laid off was one of your, I think his name was Tony Dotson. He was on your road lot. And he was fortunate enough to go to work for Leo. I think he missed 3 or 4 or 5 days, but he's been working. But he went from a full-time bidded position on your road lot to a part-time position on Leo's road lot. And my question is, you know, you got one resigning, and we're going to bid that position. You know, I personally think the fair thing to do would be award it to the Tony Dotson that lost his full-time position to begin with. I'd kind of like to ask the court. I mean, I know the what's the code say?
Well, I agree with you. Maybe John can look at our book there and tell us what it says.
I haven't
looked old.
I haven't looked at it lately, but my recollection of what the code says is when we lay people off for those budgetary reasons, that they have priority despite what the bidding rules are. So we call them back when there's an opening.
I'm glad you said that. So we could bring back the Dotson full time and put him right back in the position that he had prior to his layoff.
Yeah.
I agree 100% that we need to do that. If that is what our code says, let's make sure.
My attorney said it was.
Yes, sir.
He's an expert. Quit reading.
But Brian, you know, we want to do the right thing. And the boy that's resigning, he's getting a better job. He's a nurse, and I can see the reason him wanting to go back to the nursing. And he was a good employee, and I wished he would stay, but he decided to go and do more in his life. So, you know, we want to see him do the best he can. But that was one of the things, you know, that we wanted to talk about, and I'm glad John Doug cleared that up. And John, I've got another question. I don't know where we stand on it, and you might already have it. I didn't get to talk to you before the meeting. But on our map and lease that we done on our last CC trail, have we got that ready to adopt into the county system yet, or are we closed, or where we stand on that?
Lisa, go ahead.
I started to say, we do have it mapped. We have not got the complete, I guess, road names or whatever we want to put toward it, or don't have the road names yet, so we're still on that.
There wasn't any road names, I don't think. We were starting in the gap of Pawpaw Mountain and going through the hill, Charles, and coming out over into Peter Creek over in the Phelps. And it was mostly the old CC trail that was in existence that we just tied in with the previous CC trail from Pawpaw into Virginia there, up that way.
Yeah, what we've done over there is we've broken the trails down into segments. like the first ones that we're going to have, segment one, and segment two is going to be the next one that we're going to add into the county system. So are we going to come up with any names for the trails or the different segments or?
I think, Lisa, well, did that Phelps side have a name they was going to put on it?
We do not have one, and not that I'm aware of. So I guess we need to get together if that's the court's wishes. John Doug, is the homeowners need to be?
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Does the homeowners need to be notified on this second part of the trail, which is going to Phelps? Because I don't recall the whole trail being a CCC trail. Is that, or maybe it's, I'm not sure. Do we have it to where it's identified as the old CCC trail as far as on a map?
Yeah, I can identify each segment in a different color.
Okay.
And symbolize it like that.
At least I would imagine that the CC trail was one continuous route when they built that, so because it was built for fire purposes back when they designed that. And I guess the government just went ahead and adopted that into their program and made it a CCC fire trail road. Is that right, John?
Then it's, I think it was taken out.
As far as I know, that's correct, but I'm not exactly sure what this discussion is about at this time. Apparently, there are some property owners abutting that trail. Is that right? What is identified as the old CCC trail?
I'm not sure what the property owners are.
But there is a statutory procedure for taking roads, public roads, into the county road system, and it requires a viewing and a petition by adjoining property owners, if there are any.
I can get that.
John, if I can clear it up a little bit for you, if you remember when we first started the CC trail, it started on the top of the Papaw Mountain in the Gap, and we went right-handed and went into the state line over at Elkhorn there and Fedge Creek, went through Fedge Creek and come out over at the on the river there near the state line, and we adopted that in as our CCC fire trail road. I think we had one complaint from one of the coal companies that didn't want us to extend it on the other loop. Is that right? But the first initial loop was no complaints on it, and we went ahead and made the motion and adopted it in and made it a CCC fire trail road.
Is that the one, Lisa, that went into Virginia partially? There is a problem there, as you're well aware, with Virginia.
That was the second loop.
Yeah, okay. I need to look at a map. I'm getting loop confused here.
We probably just need to put you on a four-wheeler, John, and take you. You went one day with them on that one route.
Yeah, Brian Morris liked to drown me in a mud hole, too.
But I was hoping that we could get this thing moving on and moving along. I know there's a lot of stuff out there Lisa's looking at that we can apply for some grants and things and maybe get our people involved that live in these communities, and they've showed a lot of interest that they want to go ahead and build some cabins and do some things like they're doing over in Gilbert. I guess they just had their big Gilbert Fest over there this last couple of weeks and had a good turnout. And you know, every other county in the state seemed to me like it's interested in these trails are moving forward and doing well. And we've got 19 counties, I believe, right now, Lisa, that's doing a coalition trying to do a multi-county thing. And Sandy Runyon back there, she's helping us all she can with it. But I just think we just don't want to let this thing die down. We want to try to continue adopting these roads in the system and get them moving forward. Excuse me. And Judge, that's all I have, and hopefully that we have a successful trail ride. I'll let Lisa talk about that later on in the show. Thank you.
Judge, were you finished? All right. Just to clarify what I said earlier, I have checked the code. Section 472 deals with layoffs, hourly employees. And let me make sure the public understands, these 10 employees that have been, that have come back to employment with Pike County, Deputy Judge, they're not newly created positions. These are positions that, due to resignation, injury, whatever, have been vacated by the employees we had left. So they're not new positions. They're just filling the old positions that remained after those layoffs. Now, Section 472, Subpart 3, Subpart C says, laid off employees shall be kept on a recall panel for a period of 1 year. So that is the code. I was correct. And we can bring him back without going through the bidding process.
Good. Good.
Bobby?
Yes, Judge. We, you know, it. October has been a busy month so far. In fact, this past weekend, October the 15th, made the 40-year wedding anniversary for me. That I'm real proud of my wife for toughing that out. And but we, this is fall cleanup too with our Pride organization. And I tell you what, I can't sing enough praise for these people. They've McAndrews Church of Christ, Hardy Church of Christ, UPAC, they've been over in my district picking up garbage and litter and stuff, and I just can't say enough about them. Jimmy Dale's crew's been up in Burnwell there and doing a great job. John Doug has picked up a little bit more work on the tire disposal thing that we've been talking about, Bob, so I'm a little excited about that too, that we might be able to get something on that. So all in all, it looks like we're trying to clean Pike County up, and we're doing a good job at it, Judge. We just can't quit on it. We just got to keep on keeping on. And just wish everybody a great fall. I mean, the weather we're having, I think we set a record yesterday on temperatures, and we have today, too. So, you know, we just get out and enjoy it and look at beautiful Pike County, and it does look beautiful. Thank you.
All right. Executive session. Bobby, would you read the KRS?
Yes, sir. At this time, I make a motion that we go into executive session in accordance of KRS 61.810, paragraph F, to discuss specific personnel.
Second.
Well, wait, just, we'll do that. Our treasurer's business is next.
Authorize the necessary transfers and interfund transfers to pay the bills, payroll, health, life, dental, as we normally do each month.
Motion.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Master Anderson.
Yes.
Master Johnson.
Yes.
Master Murphy.
Yes.
Master Robinson.
Yes.
Master Dotson.
Yes.
Master Varney.
Yes.
Judge Disk.
Yes. All right.
Does anybody have questions about the bill list that has been prepared? And the accounts payable is going to be $1,172,064.65 for this month. And that will be put on the back burner. I had an email to Amy Barnes yesterday. They have not even received the reports from Revenue Cabinet to start calculating their COLA and mineral severance. So the expenditure approval list will be put on the back burner until we can get money in here, and the occupational tax will come in more towards the end of the month. So get payroll out this week and go from there. Authorization to pay the expenditure approval list is presented.
Motion.
Need a second. Roll call, please.
Master Anderson.
Yes.
Master Johnson.
Yes.
Master Murphy.
Yes.
Master Robinson.
Yes.
Master Dotson.
Yes.
Master Barney.
Yes.
Judge Deskins.
Yes.
Acknowledge receipt of the 2550 reports from the clerk and the sheriff. I passed out the sheriff's, and I think the clerk already had hers laying down here.
Motion to acknowledge.
Second.
Need a second.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Master Anderson.
Yes.
Master Johnson.
Yes.
Master Murphy.
Yes.
Master Robinson.
Yes.
Master Dotson.
Yes.
Master Barney.
Yes.
Judge Disk.
Yes.
Authorization to pay Rhonda Taylor to record the deeds from the Pike County Fiscal Court to the Pike the deed from Pike County Fiscal Court to Pike County Public Properties Corporation, deed book 1043, page 315. Total due $44.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Murphy?
Yes.
Mr. Robinson?
Yes.
Mr. Dotson?
Yes.
Mr. Barney?
Yes.
Judge Diskin?
Yes.
Authorization to reimburse Emmeline Lee $50 for her deposit at the Elkhorn City Community Center.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Murphy?
Yes.
Mr. Robinson?
Yes.
Mr. Dotson?
Yes.
Mr. Barney?
Yes.
Judge Diskin?
Yes.
Master Varney, do you want to go over the budget at this time or wait till you come back out?
We can either way. It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter to me.
Do it when we come back.
I have no further business, Judge.
Judge, I think we've got a motion on the floor to go into executive session.
Had a motion and a second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Murphy?
Yes.
Mr. Robinson?
Yes.
Mr. Dotson?
Yes.
Mr. Varney?
Yes.
Judge Diskin?
Yes.
Judge, before we go in, I'd like to say that, you know, we sometimes forget to recognize our employees that's out here on the front line that's doing the work. And I just want to say that, you know, we don't have a lot of money to make things happen, but they're here doing what they're supposed to do. And this county is moving forward, and I appreciate Brian. You know, he's out there every day trying to find monies and find things to make things happen in Pike County. And we've got a situation that we're dealing with right now, which will be on the ballot to eliminate our magistrates and commissioners. And I just want to let the people be aware, you know, we will take whatever it comes. You know, if the people want that, then that will be fine. But they need to realize that there's a lot of counties that tried the form of government as commissioners, and they couldn't wait to get it changed back because it didn't work. And the size of this county is, it will be hard to have three commissioners make things happen that they want to see happen in the county. And if you don't like the magistrates, vote them out. But please rethink your situation on changing the form of government, because it takes 4 years to get it changed back, and that's a long time. And with the situation that we're in financially, I don't know what would happen, you know. And I just sit and think sometimes the size of the districts that we all have, if you put two of them together, how would you ever be able to give people services that they need? And it's just something for people to think about. And we're not campaigning for or against. I just want to let the people know what they're up against. And I think we all need to express that to people when they ask us, are we for or against commissioner-type government? Thank you.
All right. Brian?
Got a few personnel. Need to amend Russell Hensley pay rate from a 4H to a 5H, effective 9/20. He's replacing Steve Chris Stump at row lot number 5 while he's off on illness. Need to recognize the resignation of Jimmy Bentley, effective October 28th. He's a truck driver at lot number 5. That's the position that we're going to move Tony Dotson off Leo's lot back into that position, into the full-time position. Need approval for James Dotson to temporarily replace Randy Casey as road foreman for lot number 5 at a 4-H rate of pay effective October 5th. Randy Casey's off on sick leave, and I believe I
think he said 4-H or 5-H. He told me.
At a 4-H, 4A rate of pay. I'm sorry. Thank you, John Doug. 4A rate of pay. Need approval to appoint Tim Crawford as foreman of Stone Lot Area Number 5 at his current rate of pay. I need approval to lay off Michael Coleman as a seasonal mower effective October 28th. Approval to lay off Glenn Stanley as a seasonal mower at Hardy Park, effective October 28th. Mr. Short recommendations, Bill.
Need a motion.
Hillman.
Your motion, Judge. Your motion. Your motion.
Yeah, I make the motion, we approve.
That's your recommendation, Judge.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Anderson.
Yes.
Mr. Johnson. Mr. Murphy.
Yes.
Mr. Robinson. Mr. Dodson.
Yes.
Mr. Varney.
Yes.
Judge Diskin.
Yes. All right. Okay, commissioners and directors' comments.
I've got a couple here. One is, I've been, got caught last week down on Broad Bottom at a swinging bridge down there where somebody's tucked the middle section out of 3x4. And Ratliff, the ladies want to see some way the county could take care of that. And I've been trying to find out if that's our responsibility. You'd like to help people if you can, but do it in a legal manner. And I talked to the State Department. They said it wasn't theirs. I got on Facebook and put it on there and showing the pictures of it. And a SCAF guy said they built it, SCAF engineer built it in the 1970s, and the county paid them to build it. And Rose is checking on that for me and trying to find out if that's in the system. None of the master chair, I don't think, was around, and I think him when graduated in 1970. But anyway, if anybody's got information on that, and then John Doug's researching it. And number two, and I need you all's guidance on this one, at the Brakes Park, I was up there a week and a half ago by a commissioner that represents the Kentucky side. There's three Kentuckians, three Virginians. And they showed us they got a bad hole going off a road there where people go and camp and fish. And we turn off there and another place where they stocked the waters there with trout. But it's not in a road system. The Brakes serves a great purpose for our county and can be a lot better for some entrepreneur ever got a hold of. It could be a Pigeon Forge. But right now, it's a bad little deal. And as you go down through there, they got a small slide that needs cleaned up, and a ditch drug, and some patching down a little curve. Well, the gentleman, as I was talking to John Doug and others about this, and the gentleman that's over the commission called me and asked him, you know, what I decided on that. I told him I was still working on it, but it would be a lot easier for the court. and we may could do it if they'd take care of our expense, and that is the equipment and the man hours and the materials. And he said they had no problem of doing that, but he wanted us, me to give him a figure back of what he thought it was. And probably a day and a half, 2 days of work. And I was supposed to get back with him, but I need the court to give me some guidance on this.
Just to be clear, Jackie Darrell, it's part of the Brakes Interstate Park, but the road and the property is located in Pike County.
Yes, it's in Pike County. It's not the Virginia side.
It's on the Pike County
side. Pike County side.
I just wanted to make it clear.
If I can comment on that, Judge, I have discussed this on several occasions with Jackie. I'd like to see us, if we're going to be reimbursed, be able to help the Brakes Park. The Brakes has helped. It's helped Elkhorn City. It's helped all of Pike County, frankly. However, I give legal opinions, not personal opinions. It's my legal opinion that it is unlawful to work on any public road. This would be a public road. Now, what could we do to help the Brakes and do it legally? I think, Jackie Darrell, that what we would need is an interlocal agreement with the Brakes that would entitle us to do that upon reimbursement by the Brakes. It's the same kind of interlocal agreement that this court presently has with the city of Coal Run Village and the city of Elkhorn City. We do work within those cities on streets and roads that are not a part of the county system. Some of those roads were a part of the county system, but I have referred in the past to the Supreme Court of Kentucky decision that once an incorporated area takes in an area that contains a county road, that road is no longer a county road without any action by this court, but by operation of law. So I think, Jackie Dare, what I would suggest to this court is that I draft an interlocal agreement, much like the two we have, get a cost on doing that, and tell them if they're willing to pay, if they'll sign the interlocal agreement, and if they'll pay the cost of labor, materials, and equipment cost, whatever it costs Pike County, that we could do it, if the court wants to do it.
John, in your agreement, I would like to see if you could draft up something that would let us have access to some of the roads for our ATVs that they've said they didn't want in, like up around Potter Flats and places like that. I think there's a trail at Elkhorn, isn't it, Leo, that goes by the fish pond up there, and they ride in the park area, but they've eliminated, I think, all ATVs. So, you know, if you're going to play ball, let's try to put it on an even playing field, and they need to give us a break if we're going to give them a break. That's my opinion.
Well, I'll respond briefly to that. I've not researched the issue of ATV trail riding within the park boundaries, but I believe the Breaks Park Commission would be constrained by state law, and that would be a problem there.
Well, John, I'm not talking about up in the park. I'm talking about all the areas down around Elkhorn where the park extends down into Russell Fork and all that area there. I know they have some trails that they ride right now, but I think they're limited.
If it's within the park boundary, then they would be governed by the state law of Kentucky. There's an issue on Pine Mountain, you may be aware, that linear state park up there about trail riding on it. And it has been decreed by the state that they can't do that. There's an issue about some old cemeteries up there and access to them. But, you know, I'd be glad to look into that, Master Dodson, and see. But they can't do what the state law won't allow them to do.
You know, the weather's got a little restraint on us. And if you could look in that and try to get some, me and you both try to get some speed to the deal, because weather's going to catch us where the hardtop's quitting.
Well, let me address that then. If this court is willing for me to draft an interlocal agreement, similar.
John Doug, I'll make a motion of that agreement.
Second.
But in that agreement now, does that also take in the roads that's not in the county?
No, it would. The agreement would simply give us the legal authority to work on a public road within Pike County only. We can't go to Virginia, obviously, and work on any kind of road. But it would be discretionary with the Pike County Fiscal Court whether or not to do one. It doesn't say that we're taking in all roads within the park. We're not going to do that. It would just give us the legal authority to address this one problem is all I know. Now, in the future, there may be another problem. If they come back to the road commissioner, he's going to have to make a decision. Do I want to work on this road and get paid the cost of labor, materials, and equipment? And they may want to bring it back before the court. But it's not a mandatory thing, Master Dodson.
No, I think, no, we have Jackie Darrell.
We have that agreement right now with Coal Run and Elkhorn, right?
That's correct.
So is this going to be an extra agreement or agreement or what?
Well, it'd be the same agreement in terms of wording, except it would be with the Breaks Park. The two with Elkhorn and Coal Run, we don't have to go in there and work on those roads. We've been cooperative. I guess on the theory what's good for Coal Run is good for Pike County. What's good for Elkhorn City is good for Pike County. But that's up to this court whether or not it wants to go in there and work on those roads. The present agreement says that the city governments may be charged. The word may is important. It doesn't say shall be charged. So it's up to the court whether or not it wants to charge for those. This agreement would be boarded. The Breaks Interstate Park would shall pay if we do any work.
I believe the Ratliff Hole, that's the only road they're talking about, ain't it?
Yeah, I think.
That's the only one road they're talking about. It's the Ratliff Hole over. And it's in Kentucky, you know, but it's not in Elkhorn City.
I just want to dot my I's across my T's and get the court's guidance in this.
Well, I appreciate that, and like I say, we've been very, very careful over the past couple of years about working on public roads. We've received some criticism because of past practices, customs of working on roads that maybe help people, help families. For example, with cemetery roads, but I've told you all the law a countless number of times on that. Public road leading to a public cemetery, yes, we can work on it. Otherwise, no, we can't legally do that. But I would, if there's no more discussion, Judge, we've got a motion and a second on the floor.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Murphy?
Yes.
Mr. Robinson?
Yes.
Mr. Dotson?
Yes.
Mr. Varney?
Yes.
Judge Disk?
Yes.
I've got one more issue.
Let me say, I'll have that for you tomorrow, but then the commission's going to have to approve that too.
Right.
Okay? Thank you.
My other issue, in the past, H2O, Steve Lockhart doing the work out here for Pike was busted some rock out here, and the county buys rock and puts on the side of the bank and stuff. So Steve called me and got me to ask if we wanted the rock, and I sent the road crews over there to get it, save the taxpayers' dollars, because we didn't have to buy it, and still we got it free. And I done it up Miller High School too, where they're doing some busting some rock, and sent different districts, called them, and they went up there and got the rock and saved the taxpayers' dollars. When I didn't work for the county, I'd busted some rock over there and give it to Randy. But I've got a situation now. I'm a road commissioner, so I don't want to be behind the scenes or get any bad slack to anybody. But if I save the taxpayers' dollars, I can't see where it'd be a problem. I'm doing a pretty major rock job where I'm busting a bunch of rock. I sold a few loads. Kevin Prater's come from Pipe and hauled a few loads, but I've got a lot of rock. I need to get rid of it. I could sit on it, put a store somewhere, and someday sell it, but I need to build my other building back. And I got a bunch of rock. I can save the taxpayers' dollars of having to buy it, but I wanted to present this to the court if they, you know, had anybody want to come over and get rock. If you feel I don't see nothing wrong with it, I didn't believe Monk would agree with me on that, and they have to save the taxpayers' dollars. And but I just want to say that and let the newspaper hear it, camera, I'm not trying to do something covertly. It helps me some too, get it done quicker, but save the taxpayers' dollars. Any comments on that?
Yeah, Jack, I'll comment on it. I think it would be a black eye for me and you both. We wouldn't have one, we'd have two. You know, I can see your point, and I can see the county's point, but you know how people talk. You being the road commissioner, me being the magistrate, we're over our hauling rock for Jack to clean his property up. You know, that's my opinion, and I'll leave it there.
That's the reason I brought it here. I don't know if the other magistrates feel that way, if it saved the taxpayers' dollars, because we can go up here and buy it off Elkhorn Stone or buy it over here, and I don't want to do nothing. It's, you know, has appearance of bad. The reason I'm come from the world to present this is save the taxpayers' dollars, and because we got some people out there, some of their stuff is legit, some is just bull and trying to give us problems. And this is a situation that could help the taxpayers save dollars, but it helps me too. So I want the whole court to
motion on that.
Put their 2 cents worth in.
You've lost me, Jackie Darrell, on what the issue is.
You got property that you bust the rock upon. You want to give it to the county if we want to come and get it.
Right.
But you want it out front so nobody can say anything about it.
Right.
The property that you're breaking this rock up on, is that private property?
Yes.
Personal property. Oh, your personal property?
My personal property.
And you want to give that rock to Pike County, is that right?
I'll give it to anybody who wants to come and get it. I've give some to Kevin Prater. I've sold some. But Randy, before he got sick, was asking me for that rock and wanted to give it. And I said, well, probably will give you some, Randy. I may store a little bit to sell in the future. But I'd give him some before when I didn't work with the county, when I was busting some other rock that fell years ago. But since I'm a road commissioner, I don't want to have no appearance of where I'm, you know, doing something wrong. And it's really a benefit to the taxpayers and the county to get this rock free.
Well, I understand that, but I understand what Magistrate Dotson just commented on. You know, with regard to lawyers, we're to avoid the appearance of impropriety. And why don't we table that? Let me look into it a little bit more.
That's fine. I can deal with it either way, but it'd be a mutual benefit. But I've got trucks and equipment. I can haul it and get rid of it. But if it could benefit the county, I like to benefit the county. It's like giving a donation in a way, but whatever.
Ethics committee on that.
I would, my recommendation, Judge, would be a motion to table this issue until we can do some further research, some further studies.
Motion. Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Anderson.
Yes.
Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
Mr. Murphy.
Yes.
Mr. Robinson.
Yes.
Mr. Dodson.
Yes.
Mr. Varney.
Yes.
Judge Diskins.
Yes. All right. Do you have any comments? You. Lisa.
Lisa, if you don't care, can I say something before you start? It's about your, let me get it up here. We have a trails meeting scheduled for Thursday night. I know we got the horse ride Saturday.
Yes.
They've been some talk about maybe if we can reschedule.
Yes, they have trunk or treat too here, or Nightmare on Main.
Nightmare on Main here.
Yes, so.
So.
That's a.
Hillman, you fine with rescheduling the trails meeting for this Thursday, maybe next Thursday?
I don't care what she does on it. It's up to her.
That's fine. And we'll just schedule, if it's all right with Hillman and the court, we'll just schedule the trails meeting for next Thursday instead of this Thursday, since the city has activities going on in town. So thank you.
It's next Thursday. The 27th?
Yes.
Okay. What time?
6:30 here. And that's for the trails meeting.
Could I ask the question? There's an employee asked me yesterday, are we going to have the county appreciation dinner or anything this year?
We had it at Christmas last year, so we'll see about planning around Christmas.
Well, okay. I was just asked that question yesterday. Yeah. Okay.
We'll just have to see.
We did it last year with donations, didn't we? We didn't.
Have to do it with donations, yeah. If we can get any.
Right.
Yeah.
Might not have something.
Yeah, we may.
Tell you what, Bobby and Hillman can make some good fish.
I'll fry.
So you guys can make some good fish. I've had it.
We could have breakfast.
That's okay.
Breakfast Hillman. Is good, too.
Now, you might have spoke.
Hey, Hillman makes
make a good biscuit.
Oh, look, sounds good. Everybody fix it at home. Bring it in. Makes it easier, really. Cleaner. Easy to clean up.
Okay, updates. Leo, in your district, the fire hydrant for Hurricane Branch, the equipment is in, and it's scheduled to go in for next week. So if you'll let the residents know that the fire hydrant will be replaced there next week.
That's all right.
That one.
Thank you.
We do have the horse ride, and I think I've got a picture on it. We have the horse ride coming in this Saturday. Registration will start at 8. Usually we start the ride at 10. We do serve lunch for the horse trail ride, and it's up at Lick Creek. It's this Saturday. The other community thing we have at in Hillman's district, and Hillman can talk more about it, is the Community Fall Festival, which is Saturday, October 29th at the Hatfield-McCoy Park. That's two of the events that we have going on. We did have a ATV trail ride on October the 8th. It was raining that morning. I had a meeting in the Breaks Park with the Secretary of Tourism, Parkinson's, on our new adventure that we're exploring. So I wasn't able to make it, but in speaking with Willie Runyon, it was a good event. They still had several people show up. And they went ahead and rode regardless of the weather. So that was a good ATV ride. The other thing we got going on is Teleworks. Teleworks is in the process of interviewing next week for their manager and their assistant manager for our new Teleworks program that we will be bringing to the county. Thanks to Paul and his crew and jailer Freddie Lewis and his inmates for helping us out to get that building ready for them to occupy. Probably within the next month and a half, they'll be up and running, ready to go.
They told us first the 17th that they were going to hire the manager, wasn't it?
Yes, and they're going to interview next week. I think we're behind just a little bit, by a couple of weeks. So we do have on the 27th the Department of Fish and Wildlife coming in to view the two areas we have for ramps. One in Magistrate Hillman's Dotson's district and one in Bobby Varney's district. So we have that coming on the 27th. I think that's about it besides the House Bill 303 projects, which you'll address when we get to that point.
Lisa, where we stand on our crumb rubber that we had scheduled to start putting down?
Well, that's been an issue. Lisa with the Department of Waste Management will be in town Thursday, Friday to view this. The person or the company we actually purchased the rubber from was on their list as a merchant that we could purchase from. But when it came in, we decided, the court decided, and Department of Waste Management decided that that was not quality crumb rubber. So the state is going to be sending that back. She's coming in this weekend to view all of that. We'll be sending that back, ordering new crumb rubber. They're going to give us a new extension, so we will be able to finish all our projects. So, I mean, I hate the delay, but we are getting it covered and sending it back, and it just takes a little bit of process. We had no idea when it came in, which they didn't either, that the quality was not going to be that we wanted for our projects.
Since that's delayed, can we get back to the river ramps that we had scheduled? You said after the crumb rubber's over, you'll get them started doing that one ramp up in Woodman.
Well, as soon as I talked to John Doug about that with the property. Remember the Woodman property that we put the sign on and trying to find out the ownership of that? And you said we might can go ahead and start working on that?
I know this ramp don't qualify. You done got the two. But we can get it ready for the next round that they're going to approve and get it cleaned up, you know, fall of the year here. And we got the dozer sitting over there, and if Paul can work with us and you can work with us, maybe we can go ahead and get that started, because we've told the people that that's going to happen. And
as long as we have the legal part taken care of to go ahead and start that, I have no problem. I do know I'm pushing Paul pretty thin because I do have the horse trail ride this coming up he's working on and the teleworks project.
I understand that. I'm talking about after that trail ride's over with.
We should be able to, as long as there's legally.
Talking to Terry Rogers, he's going to help with the trail ride.
Yes.
And I don't know if he's got any volunteers or not, but the last time I talked to him, he was trying to get help up there that day to help do the ride. Have you got enough people now to do it?
I don't know if there's enough. Hopefully we'll have enough. We do have several people that's volunteered to come up and help.
Yeah, I know we've raised money for the meal that's been purchased or being prepared. Mm-hmm. Terry, I think you got enough volunteers right now to move forward. I think that was our last conversation. So, yeah, I think everything's good going forward on it.
Are they going to be able to go in on both ways this year from Furls Creek side and get to the scene to work on the meals? Paul, can they come in from up on Furls Creek?
Yeah, we can come in.
Like you went in last year, Lisa.
We can come in on Morgan's Creek up there. You know, like I said, the road's a little bit rough, but we're gonna try to bring a dozer back out there. We got the little dozer up in there trying on them mud holes and grader. And we're gonna try to bring it back out Morgan's Creek. So you can come in right down to the camp up there. You know.
Morgan's Creek, you're talking about old Lick Creek?
Yeah, I'm talking Lick Creek. I'm talking right down at where the second campground is.
Well, we always did before.
Yeah.
What I was asking, can you come in from up at Furls Creek, down the hill where y'all first wanted to put a ramp in up there, you know, to where the road was kind of steep and rough.
Middlefield area, is that
Middlefield.
It? Middlefield area?
Middlefield.
Yes.
Yeah.
We did.
Can you come in from that? Will the gates be open where you can go in that way?
Yeah, we can have the gates open there, yeah.
I know it's a lot quicker than trying, if you're going up there to cook or something, and that way you're not pushing the horses and things.
We'll have the gates open where you can come right down to second camp.
Okay.
And you are cooking this year? You'll be there to help?
Well, if I'm here, I will.
Okay. That's all I have, Judge. Thank you.
All right. John Turney, John Doug, you have anything?
Briefly, Judge. This court is aware that the litigation with UMG concerning the open records matter, a request by this court, has now gone from the Court of Appeals to the Supreme Court on a motion for discretionary review. Judge, in light of the fact that my days may be short working for county government, I have a recommendation. I would ask the court for authorization to bring David Kaplan in as co-counsel so that there can be some continuity in this case. David did excellent work in our severance tax lawsuit, and I would ask the court for authority to bring him in as co-counsel, so if I do leave, and I am gone when this matter comes to a head, that we've got somebody involved who's ready to pick it up and run with it. It's very complicated issues on this appeal concerning legislative history, concerning constitutionality. UMG has felt it important enough to go outside and get two Jefferson County attorneys, not the county attorney, but two attorneys from Jefferson County, to pick up the ball and run with it for UMG. So I'd ask the court for authority to bring David Kaplan in.
Motion.
Need a second.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Anderson.
Yes.
Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
Mr. Murphy.
Yes.
Mr. Robinson.
Yes.
Mr. Dodson.
Yes.
Mr. Barney.
Yes.
Judge Deskins.
Yes. All right. Pike County Judge Executive comments. I'm going to be quiet.
Wow. John Doug, well, you had the first reading of that amendment I reached you for the House Bill 303.
Thank you. I forgot all about that. This is a first reading of an ordinance amendment. It's amendment number one. It's an ordinance in summary form relating to the annual budget and amendment thereof. Whereas Pike County, Kentucky has realized unbudgeted receipts, be it ordained by Pike County of the Commonwealth of Kentucky, that the revenues, section one is the revenues, are amended to reflect $412,000, and that the total amended expenditures be in the same amount, $412,000. I might say this is LGEA pass-through money. Is that correct? It's not out of the county budget.
No. From the single county.
That's the first reading, and summary form requires no further action at this time, Judge.
All right. Well, I need a motion to adjourn.
Bobby wanted to do the budget review after the meeting, after the executive session.
Yes. John, first let me say I want to thank you for the information that you gave us last court meeting and stuff. That was very helpful. In all that stuff, did you see any red flags of areas that were coming up short or anything?
I mean, I can pick things apart, but I think there's places that are, the big thing is waiting to see how the taxes come in and see what this next quarter of coal and mineral will do. Just like I tried to get information from Amy last night, but the revenue cabinet is being slow to get them the full reports for coal and mineral so that they can calculate what our checks will be. The occupational taxes being for the first quarter has come in 50 some thousand more than we expected, which is a good thing, and hopefully that will continue on trend to help us with any shortfalls we may have. The strip mine permit fees, we had $67,225 budgeted, and we only got $39,947.92. So there's $27,000. But there's some other places. We got an unmined mineral tax check I wasn't expecting in this year of $76,000 that'll help to buffer any shortfall in revenues if I've overestimated them. I try to be very conservative with them. But looking at the revenues as an overall budget, the revenues are at 24.17%. And the expenses are at 21.93%, which is right at 22%. So we're, you know, keeping our head above water at this point. There's some funds that may be over and some that are under, but And I have given this report also to the jailer to let him see what his revenues are.
Mm-hmm.
And his revenues at this point are good. He's come in at 22.71%, and his expenses, because there's a couple of places, and one place in particular in his expenses I was a little worried about, that I told him to look at to see if there's some place they're going to be able to cover it with the cleaning supplies. His expense side is 27.97, so he's running a little high compared to the revenue so far. Just trying to keep a tab on it. I've given the information to the jailer to look through his budget to see if there's any place that he can cut back and not put it in an out of balance budget and stuff for us, and watching his revenue. People have to understand this budget ended up being $36 million, 807. But in the general fund, Jimmy Kaiser alone has $484,900, $900,000, $2,211,000, and $2,700,000. Those numbers is what bumped it up, or it would have been down closer to a $29 million budget or $28 million, and take out FEMA. But those are things we have to budget, but there's not things that we can spend. And you know, this is a very lean budget. Someone had asked me the other day what was our largest budget and what was the budget currently, and I said, well, that's not fair, because you have things inside the budget that people don't understand really needs to come out of it, because there's nothing else we can do with it.
Can I ask that question, John, to just off memory? I know
in
you don't
99.
Know. Take out the pass-through. You know, just take out the pass-through and get to the bottom line. This year is about 29.
28 or 29 million.
What would be the highest?
The highest year was the 98-99 year when Judge Dameron was going out and Judge Gibson was coming in. Our budget that we prepared that year was $59 million, but that had a lot of pass-through monies, too. That was for the expo. That was for water sewer projects that were going on with the work between Judge Dameron and Governor Patton at the time that the county was getting. But we prepared a $59 million budget that year.
Mm.
And then before that, it was only in the 20-some thousands, and it got up into the 30s. So we're looking at a 20-year-old budget number when you look back to see.
I get that question a lot. That's the reason why I asked.
Yeah. 99-2000 was $59 million. But that had the expo money and water and sewer projects, the work between Governor Patton and Judge Dameron at the time.
John, a lot of employees has asked me questions on how we stand this year with our budget, whether they're looking at layoffs or cuts and I tell them I think we're going to be stable, and hopefully we won't have to see any more cuts.
Well, just like the one quarter of coal severance we got, it is down from what we had budgeted. It came in at 17.4% when it should have been at 25, but the mineral came in at 29.27, so I'm hoping between the two figures that they'll even each other out. If the coal was too much, that the mineral maybe will go up and help us to offset that potential there.
But
we won't know until we get a few more quarters. And it's like I said before, it takes January or February for us to know, because you've got the solid waste tickets will go out at the end of January. You've got the sheriff going to start collecting taxes November 1. You've got big numbers that are out there that'll be January or February before we truly know what's going to happen.
I may be wrong, Hillman, and John, tell me if you think I'm wrong, but I think this year's budget, you know, like she's commented on, the co-severance is coming in less, but we're picking up on the gas tax. You know, I'm confident that this year's budget, we're not going to be sitting around the table needing to cut 5 or 6 million like we've had the last couple of years. I really think this is a good budget that we prepared to put forward. You know, now at the end of the year, we may be $100,000, $200,000 shy. because we don't, I mean, we're estimating a year out what we're going to get in. That being said, we're not going to be sitting around the table needing to cut $5 or $6 million like we've had the last couple of years. I get the same question from the county employees. I'll be amazed that if we need to do anything at the end of this year other than just maybe reshuffle a thing or two. I really think that we got the budget in line, not to only move the budget forward, but also move the county forward with things that Lisa and I was working on with Teleworks, the artisan property, and other things that we're working on. I really think we're moving forward in the right direction as far as the county.
And Brian, I believe too the coal is going to be better in the next quarter because you see more coal, more trucks, more people going back to work. That's going to help you budget all around.
And anytime any of you magistrates may see a new business, a new anything, contact the occupational tax office and let them know, because they're really trying to help us to get as much as they can with making sure everybody's paying, so that way we are getting the numbers we're getting from them, because last year's average was $750,000. So they have done, we can see that there's extra something going on in the county for them to have picked up these kinds of numbers since we lost Elkhorn City for the $80,000, $20,000 a quarter for that one.
Eastridge. I'm going to say this, and I'm going to hush. And we put this out last year that, you go back 4 or 5 years ago, what this county was getting in just on co-severance tax was $12 million. We got in, I think, a little over $1 million last year.
Right.
Just estimate. I mean, it's a little over $1 million we got. I mean, that's $11 million that this court had to work on moving this county from bankruptcy to where we are today. I mean, I really think that we've done an excellent job in getting to this point and even working on moving the county forward,
Because we've only got 2.47 or 8 budgeted for coal and mineral, and you're coming down from $10 and $8 million that we used to get.
That's $10 million that used to be fed in this county to take care of the things that Pike County citizens has got accustomed to taking care of. And just to think that we battled through that to be where we are today to move the county forward, I mean, I'm kind of proud of what we've done here the last couple of years.
And the magistrate's road accounts have took a hit because they got up to where I think it was $250,000 they had a year, and we're down to $165,000. So that was for the biggest part of coal severance was going, so because we have to have a percentage that we have to use of that with our roads. So we're doing good. The 2.5 was definitely needed. Hopefully we're getting, after this quarter, we can start getting things pumped up. This will be the last payment on our workers' comp and liability insurance, and that'll be behind us. So that increases the number of what the expenses was too, because it 100% whenever it's not an equal keel every month going out. But right now we're holding our own. Hopefully nothing falls out or bottoms out anymore on us.
Well, maybe we're on the rebound.
Adding to what Hillman said, I've seen coal trucks all over the county now that I used to not see. And I done away with one of my big gas lines that slides under the truck because diesel fuel would slow down. Yesterday I added it back onto my diesel tank because I had 4 tractor trailers in my lot getting fuel. So things is looking better on a positive note.
Mm-hmm. Is there any other questions or anything you'd like for me to highlight?
Just a couple things. John, on the, I'd like to see, and this doesn't have to be done today, tomorrow or something, but I'd like to see a comparison of what our payroll was 2 years ago, 3 years ago, and what it was this past quarter.
Okay.
Because we did lay off some people and we did squeeze and stuff. I want to see what that's doing to the bottom line. And
I think the last time I put payroll checks in the bank, I was thinking that had cut like 50 to 75,000 a payday, but don't hold me for quoting that.
That's just payday. That's not.
That's every 2 weeks.
But that's just payroll. That's not benefits?
Yes, that's everything.
That's everything, benefits?
That was what I was putting together, was thinking it was about. It's $50,000 to $75,000, but I'll get a better number on it, because I was thinking that to myself of putting the checks in the bank.
Yeah. And another thing, I would like to, here in the next month or so, to have a special call meeting if we need to do it or whatever, but have our health insurance carrier to come in and talk to us about looking for next year's health insurance.
Okay.
Just don't wait up that 11th hour and say, okay, we got to do this and do that. And you know, because I think we owe it to our employees to try to get them the best policy that we possibly can. And I want to start on that now.
Well, the one thing, speaking to Kelly, he can come in and talk to us about anything. But the one thing is, Anthem will not have a claims run until, I think it's the end of March, for them. That's what they need in order to start soliciting to see what the proposals can be. So it'll be the end of March before to get a true year of how much the claims are, and that's what they base the renewals on.
But if Kelly could come in just for
he can probably one of the do some sessions, loss runs so far,
and we could lay some questions out to him. That way, when that stuff comes in, we can put that all together.
And speaking of the insurance, from where we were paying $220,000-some, we've got the bill for September, and it's down to $50,000-some. We had some hiccups with the September bill. I had to pay some people that they didn't get off in time, but we'll get the credits back in November. But the bill in October was only $52,000, I think, is what we paid out in health insurance compared to $225,000.
And I know we've done a lot in the cuts, the layoffs, everything about saving money, but I'd like to be proactive on this and look at some things right now that we could do to save some money. And, you know, look for suggestions from these gentlemen and stuff on doing that.
Okay.
There's no more questions, Judge. I think we've got a motion to adjourn on the floor.
Judge, before you adjourn, I got one more question.
Oh, sure.
I need to find out the situation with our Mack truck, Frankie. We still don't have any truck, and they don't know when they're going to get it fixed or if they're going to get it fixed. And right now is the time when we haul them blacktop, and I appreciate the other district letting us use their truck to help, but you know, there should be something we can do when we pay a lease on a contract for so many months and we don't have access to that truck for 2 months. You know, it should be something that could happen. I don't know the answer, but I'm asking John Doug, and I thought I heard him say he had a short time here, but John, I hope you'll reconsider that, because you are one we look to help us and direct us, and I hope you don't retire.
Thank you for that, Mr. Dodson. That's very kind of you. But let me say, I'll get with Frankie if you remind me tomorrow, Frankie, and look at their contract.
Well, that's what I was going to say, is the contract we've got now, that when we bid those trucks back in March, doesn't have that language in it about a backup truck. I know you'd told me a meeting ago to make sure that the next time we bid that out, that it does have language that if a truck is down for an extended period of time, that they have something. And I did do that, but as far as this contract we have now, there's no language in there that says that they're responsible to provide us a truck.
What kind of language, if you recall, and I'll look at it tomorrow, is in there on warranties?
It would just be the manufacturer's warranty. And like I said, they're working on the truck, and they're not billing us for it. I mean, it's just the extended period of time that they've been working on this.
That's not helping us get blacktop hauled either.
Right.
You know,
and that's what I say, as far as a replacement truck, while the other truck is down, there's no language in our contract now that would require them to give us a truck.
Most people that sell vehicles, and you buy a new car, they got a warranty on it. They'll give you a loaner or something until they fix yours. I mean, that's
common sense. I mean, we could ask them, you know, as a courtesy, but, you know, we don't have nothing in writing that would require them to give us a backup truck. Now, next year's bid, you know, and I can work with John Doug to make sure the language is right, but I did put like a, you know, part of the special conditions that an extended period of time, I said like 10 days, if they can't fix that vehicle within that period of time, that they provide us a backup truck.
Would,
but I can't do anything about it for the contract we've already awarded back in March for this year's lease.
Mr. Dodson, if I may suggest, if you would, after I review these documents, make a motion to authorize me to contact this company that leased the trucks to us with regard to potential legal action, if I think such is viable. I will write them a letter and suggest very strongly that we're anticipating, contemplating that, and if I think there are grounds. So if you'll go ahead and give me authority to do that, I'll proceed.
Well, John, I'll make a motion that we do that. But
let me add something to this.
Let me finish. Last count we had with them, they didn't know what was wrong with it. They said they had every wire in it pulled out, trying to get to find a problem. And they'd sent it to another garage, and they can't find it. And, you know, evidently, there's a bad problem there with that truck. And when we award the bids next year, we need to be aware of that. And we do a lot of business with this company, you know. It's not small. And
There may be.
I called the company after last fiscal court meeting and talked to the guy down in Louisville. And I told him, you know, it'd been a good procedure. We'd worked out for both parties in the past. But in our last court meeting, we've had a lot of problems. District 5 for 3 months or so, we've had a problem with the truck. And not only that one, we've got a problem with District 3's truck also. And I said, it's situations worked out good for you and us both, but when we are not getting service and can't do our blacktop, you know, something's going to be done. And the court's going to take some actions. And I said, you need to get with your head people and get back with us and compensate us some way for this problem which is created, you know, by us not having to service this truck. And he's told me he'd get with their chiefs and get back with me. And that's about 5 days ago I called him and had to call back. But he's made aware of this, that this court may take some kind of action because we are not getting what we expected out of this deal.
I'll second Hillman's motion.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Murphy?
Yes.
Mr. Robinson?
Yes.
Mr. Dodson?
Yes.
Mr. Barney?
Yes.
Judge Diskin?
Yes.
Motion to adjourn.
Need a second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson? Mr. Murphy?
Yes.
Mr. Robinson? Mr. Dodson? Mr. Barney? Judge Diskin?
A big zero.